Hello, everyone. Hello, I'm Gemma Starr, and welcome to another episode of Heart Warriors. This is a series I've been inspired and guided to do thanks to my energetic connection with Katajuda. Katajuda is the sacred masculine site in Central Australia, very close to Uluru, our sacred feminine site. What I'm here to do is to give a platform to our men so they can speak of their experience, their journey into the heart. They can share their practices, wisdom, tools, insights with other men watching, and of course, us women who are walking right there beside them. You know, for so long, us women have been trying to tell men how to be men, but they need to hear it from other men, and this is what this show is all about. Our guest today is a man called Scotty Ze, and he is an Aussie living over in Russia. He's a transformational and integral mentor, and he's also a fearless freedom fighter. So I'm very excited to be talking to Scotty and hearing all about his journey into the heart. Enjoy. Hello, Scotty Ze. Welcome to Heart Warriors.
Thank you, Gemma. It's great to be here.
Oh, good one. And you're an Aussie living in Russia, is that right?
It is very interesting. Yes, I've been here for, it'll be 2 years in April. We lived here a year earlier. My son was born here. I met my Russian wife in Bali. We were both living in Bali. Where does an Aussie meet a Russian? In Bali, because there's lots of both of us there. We just met at a cafe, fell in love, story goes. And then when we fell pregnant, she said she wanted to have our son in Russia. So I moved to St. Petersburg. That was in end of 2017. And we spent a year living in St. Petersburg. And then we went back to Australia for 2.5 years. And then during the pandemic, I knew what was happening, and it was just getting worse and worse and worse. The control mechanisms, they were threatening to close the borders to people that were not silly enough to follow along with the agenda, which we were never going to do. And my wife was quite worried that they would lock us out and that she wouldn't be able to travel back and see her family. And they're very close, the very traditional people here in Russia. So eventually she twisted my arm enough, and I could see that Australia was only going to get worse with the control mechanisms. And so we made the move, which is for the most part amazing. I love living here. It's a beautiful place. The dollar goes a lot further, so it's sort of like, you know, living in Bali style, where it is a lot more affordable. And the people leave each other alone. And that's something that I find very, very refreshing. I always felt a little bit henpecked in Australia. Like everyone sort of wants you to stay in the lane with everybody else, you know, whether it's on the road or in the supermarket or just anywhere you go. If you're a little bit different in Australia, people tend to pick on you a little bit. And I'm a little bit different, and I like being myself. But here in Russia, everyone just leaves each other alone. You just do your thing and it doesn't really matter. It's a little bit of the Wild West. So you can sort of get away with things here that you could never get away with in Australia, especially on the roads, which I really enjoy. But otherwise, yeah, I like it here. The only downside, and everybody says it, isn't it cold? Yes, it's bloody freezing. It's bloody freezing. That's the only catch. I grew up in Cairns, far north Queensland, in the tropics. Met my wife in Bali, Indonesia, my chosen home. And all of a sudden, it's minus 13 outside right now and covered in snow. So it is cold. But because I work on the internet, we choose to travel over winter. So middle of January, we're heading down into Egypt, into the Red Sea for 3 months for the rest of the winter. So we'll have Christmas. They have a late Christmas in January 9th is actually when Jesus was born. So, you know, in Orthodox Christianity, I believe the Russian Orthodox and the Greek Orthodox as well. So after that, after the Christmas here with the family, we're on a plane a week later and we're out of here. So having that option makes it more bearable and enjoyable.
Oh, so good. Lots of good things happening for you, Scotty, and your family. What adjectives would you use to describe the man you are today without all the fancy outside labels? Who is Scotty Ze inside?
A seeker, if anything. I'm wholly curious. I'm very, very curious about who I am, about what this is. You know, what is this place? That's the question that I'm asking myself constantly and have done for 20 years. I'm doing my best to be a man of integrity. I want to be, and integrity is not just like what I say is what I do, but actually like be fully integrated, where I'm a complete being, and I'm one with the complete being, you know, whatever you would call the oneness. Like, that to me, integrity is very, very important. And obviously that integrity of being one with spirit, one with who I really am, then overflows into my business dealings, into the people that I meet. So I'm doing my best to be that for myself, but also to shine that through, so that, because another adjective is I am a guide. I've always been a guide. I was a professional adventure guide through my 20s, started as a scuba dive instructor on the Great Barrier Reef at 20 years old. I guide 10 different adventure sports through my 20s, traveled around the world doing that, and then got into the personal development space at about the age of 27. And then I've been coaching and leading programs and teaching and stuff like that ever since. I'm 41 now. So that's sort of my profession, is I'm a guide. So I'm doing my best to realize myself as spirit, to be love, and then allow that to flow through me so that other people, through my guidance, can appreciate that in themselves as well.
Oh, so good, Scotty. Thank you. Can we get into...
It's a great question, by the way. I've never had that question. What adjective? That's a really great question.
Well, I decided to make it a bit more specific because some people like... Anyway, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
You answered it perfectly. Well done. Brownie points. Now I forgot. Oh, yes. Can we get a bit deeper into what an integrated man is? How would you...
Well, that's a great question. Yeah, yeah. Let's explore that. So an integrated man. So I don't think it's just to be an integrated man. I think all of us are here to integrate fully into who we are. We would say like body, mind, and spirit. Right? It's like there's these three distinct aspects of us. I can feel my physical body, but I can imagine in my mind, and I can feel this intuitive feeling of spirit. And so to me, rather than them being three separate things that have three separate labels, I'm doing my best to be whole in all of them so that they're all completely flowing. I'm trying to use a word other than integrated, flowing together. The life force energy is flowing between them. So that when I heal my body, I'm healing my spirit, because I think a lot of the work that we're doing here is healing, because generationally we've been abused, we've been held down, there's literally a Buddha on our throats, right? And I think a lot of what we're doing here is we're saying no more of that, and I will heal myself so that the future generations don't have to deal with that. So I want, like, I do a lot of medicine work. So I work with the plant medicines from the Amazon. I flew to the Amazon in 2015 and it absolutely changed my life. And then ever since then, it's just been a beautiful journey with the plant medicine. So I sat 2 weeks ago, another ceremony. And for me, I get the greatest sense of that oneness in the medicine, because the boundaries between physical, mental, and spirit, or soul, whatever you want to call it, dissolve. And I can feel the connection between all of them. And then outside of the medicine, I'm doing everything I can to live that experience in my day-to-day life. Yeah, so my thoughts are creating my physical body. My physical body is creating my thoughts. And we know that to be true. You know, if you want to change the way that you feel or the way that you're thinking, go and do a strong exercise, right? The number one cause of disease is stress, is mental stress. Right. So we know that there is an overlap there. But I would dare say also that we are being guided, that we, you know, we know through astrology that all of these laser beams of light, be it from the moon and all of the planets, are literally programming our reality every single moment. And therefore, I would say, you know, they say, oh, God is above. There's always been this above. If you look up, like, that is above, right? That is shining down on us. So I feel that we are divinely guided, and that we have a mission on this planet to live out. And the body and mind are here as tools and instruments of Great Spirit to use us in this reality. And the job that I'm here to do is to let go of that separate self, that egoic self, that I'm more special than or different from self. And it has a place in its place, like a knife has a place, but you don't want to walk around the room with a knife all the time, you know, or use it inappropriately. It has its place. But for me, it's about realizing myself beyond the limited form and moving into the unlimited form, and therefore able to be an instrument for great spirit to use me, to work through me, to say the words that spirit wants to say, to make the moves that spirit wants to make. And I get to, as my individualized form, be a witness of that play. In the Vedic tradition, they call it the Leela, right? Krishna has the flute. I used to play that flute when I was in the Himalaya. I started learning Krishna's flute, and he plays the divine Leela. This whole thing is a game. People are likening it now to a simulation or a simulated experience like a computer game. It really is. In the spiritual text, it talks about that, right? We know the binary code of the internet is exactly how you and I are looking at each other in real time right now. That's how the entire reality works. You've got an on and an off switch. You that's just how it works. You'd call it a yin and a yang, or masculine and a feminine. Doesn't matter what words you use. There's this side and that side. And when they move interchangeably, that's how we're able to see, hear, speak, the waveform of light. Like, it is all a simulated experience. And I believe that I am but an instrument of the creator, and that I am here to fully let go of the fear that anything can actually hurt me in this binary code simulation, move beyond the control that fear itself enslaves me in, because that's the only thing that we're enslaved by is fear, move beyond that and be in full trust. Because the antithesis of fear is not love. Love is everything. The antithesis of fear is trust. And as soon as I trust that everything is taken care of, that I am divinely guided in each moment, that I have a mission, that I am placed in this perfect moment at this perfect time to be saying these perfect words, taking these perfect actions, and therefore nothing that is perceived as wrong or bad can actually harm who I truly am, to let go of that fear completely and just be that instrument of God, of love. That's what I'm here to do. And that's what my life is every single day.
Oh, Scotty, this is amazing. I would have said exactly the same thing if I could articulate as well as you. And yeah, I mean, but okay, let's continue this thread now. Does one have to be pretty progressed on their healing journey for this divinity to work through us? Is that why people embark on their healing journey and, you know, progress? Do we have to get to a certain point of being unblocked emotionally and mentally and even physically to allow this divinity to express and work through us?
It's always working through us, and we're always perfectly placed. There's a point in time that we then begin to realize that that is the case. Right? It's always happening, but there's a point where we're ignorant to it and we don't know. And then we start to realize and see the signs that that's happening in our life. And that then becomes a lot easier because the cognitive mind starts to recognize that, so we're not fighting against it. But it doesn't mean that it's always going to be easy. Like, you imagine if you're walking in the forest and all of a sudden you get stuck in a marsh, in a bog, you know, and you're knee deep in mud, you know, you're going to have to get out of that. You can pray that it was different, or you could, you know, say I'm above this or whatever. It doesn't matter. You're still going to have to dig your way out, step by step, out of the mud. We were born into the mud. I don't know about your family, but my family were brainwashed, were controlled by the system. You know, my dad gave his lifeblood just to raise a family, fighting uphill the whole way. I was raised in that. You know, I have that vibration in me. So the healing that I'm doing is not just healing to help my son and hopefully my daughter coming soon, but also to heal my father, because there is no past and present or future. It's all one timeline, right? We only see that in the waveform of this reality. But when I'm healing here, I'm healing for my father. I'm healing for my grandfather. So we have to do that work. It doesn't mean it's going to be easy. Right? It doesn't mean, but we have to, like the marshing, we have to get out of the marsh in order to get onto the firm ground again. Right? So we're always being guided. We're always being taken care of. But there comes that point in the journey where we start to lift our head up from the hard work and go, all right, it's still a bit of hard work, but I reckon I'm all right. I'm taken care of. You know, I'm not on my own here. You know, there's something else here that I can feel the hand of God, or whatever word is, like I can feel the universe pulling me forward, whatever way you want to experience it in your own life. That then starts to go, wow, okay, there's like another energy here beyond just what I think where my body ends. And as I go deeper into that, because we're naturally curious, we want to know what that is. Where does the boundaries of I and you end? Right? Like I'm sleeping in bed with my wife and I'm breathing out the cells of my body, you know, and she's breathing them in. Does that mean that, you know, I end at the bottom of her lungs? You know, like where do we begin and where do we end? That's just an example, but where do all of us begin and we end? We start to explore the boundaries of who we are and we get into that intuitive feeling of there's more to me than meets the eye or touches the eardrum, you know, and then we go in deeper and explore that. And then it becomes a whirlwind of experience because everything is imbued with God. Everything is imbued with that love essence, the vibrational frequency, the white matrix that all life, the positive and negative created on top of that love frequency, we start to experience that, right? And that's why I like the medicine, because the medicine disconnects the physical and mental from just being in this subjective reality and allows us to take a step out of it and go, holy, that's how it looks. That's what it looks like. The fractal geographic patterns that this whole thing is made. Wow. Right. And then boom, you're back in your past. Boom, you're seeing in the future. Boom, you come into reality. Over the next few days, you're like integrating it all. Like, wow. Okay. Now I see the world in a different way. Right. Now I can start to make choices from a different perspective, because it's like somebody putting you in a helicopter and going, that's what the terrain looks like. All right. Walk it. And you're like, cool, I've seen it now. I know what it looks like. I've got a map and a picture in my head because I've had the 40,000 foot view. Now I can come back into reality and I can start to navigate it a lot easier. People do that through meditation. They have a spiritual experience in meditation, right? Where you have that Kundalini awakening where you're fully embodied in oneness. And then you come back down, you're like, whoa, now I get to integrate that. And I say that because that's what happened to me when I was 21. That's what started this journey for me. I had a full body embodiment, full Kundalini activation. Didn't know what it was. I was 21, you know, but then I was like curious about what the hell was that? And I'd been meditating before that and starting down the path. So I'd been curious already reading the books, but that was like, boom, now experience that, Scotty, every day. It's like, okay, because that's love. I want to feel that every day. Okay, let's go. What do I need to do? And that's been the journey for me, is just being like, that's the North Star. I've had the touch of divinity. What do I need to do to be that every single day?
Oh, so good. Well, let's get into your childhood. What was the biggest struggle for little Scotty here in Australia?
It was probably what I mentioned earlier, was being different.
How were you?
I've always just done it my way, right? I've always been my own man and I don't like being told what to do. I'm a natural entrepreneur. Like I'm an entrepreneur. I create businesses and add value in the world in very unique and distinct ways. That's what I like to do. So today, a lot of us are celebrated in that. You know, you see the innovators and the creators and, you know, the visionaries creating life in different ways. Like there is, you know, entrepreneurship is very sexy these days. But when you're a kid growing up in freshwater, far north Queensland, you know, going to school barefoot and everybody's working class, you know, my dad was a courier driver. And then for the last 20 years, he put the dishes on and off the airplanes. So he'd take the, you know, dishes, drive the truck and put the dishes on and off. You know, my mum worked in a cafe and then built up and had her own little cafe herself, you know, working class, everyone's working class family. And here I am just like, wow, so curious. Like I begged mum and dad to buy the encyclopedias when the guy come knocking on the door because I wanted to learn. I used to sit there and just pull out the old school books, pull out the encyclopedia and just read, you know, like that was my fun time just to learn stuff. So I was very, very different, but I was also very strong. And so you couldn't, like, I wasn't the nerdy kid that you'd pick on. Because if you pick on me, I'd be up and, you know, I started training karate when I was 10. I pushed my dad. I was like, I want to train karate. Dad's like, karate? What are you talking about, karate? It's like the 90s in far north Queensland, you know, Bruce Lee things. I don't know what it was. I just wanted to train martial art. I got a black belt in karate. I've trained for 30 years. I love it. I can't get enough. But so I wasn't to be pushed around. I knew who I was. I was very strong. But I was always like, you know, you're weird. What do you, you know, I used to cop that a lot. You're so weird. Why can't you just be normal? You know, why can't you be like everyone else? Hey, why can't you be like everyone else, boy? I don't want to be like you. I really don't want to be like you. So I had a lot of like social pressure to be a certain way that I just could not be. And therefore I was ostracized a bit. I was always very popular because I'm quite charming. You know, I it's just who I am. I know who I am. It's not a, like blowing smoke up my ass. Like I meet people well, I connect with people well. So people always liked me and always respected me, but I was always a little bit strange. I was always a little bit like Scotty's doing Scotty, you know, and people didn't really understand that. So that was the hardest thing for me in Australia, is just, I never wanted to fit in. What is it? There's an old saying, it is no measure of success to be well-adjusted in an inherently sick society.
Yeah, such a good quote. That's great, Scotty. So it just seems that was, you know, you were born into the role of that. So I don't think we need to explore that one any further. I think I would say that was actually a, because most people talk about some sort of wound, but I see that's actually, you know, a gift that you embraced the whole way through. So take us to your
It has been difficult as well, though. I'll leave that part just because you've opened something that is not entirely true. That has been one of the biggest things, because I created a shell around me to not let people hurt me.
Okay.
Right. So I've had to learn to love myself for who I am, because so many people said that there was something that wasn't right about me. And so that was a really big journey for me, was just self-love, just being okay with me being me, regardless of anybody else's expectations or beliefs about myself. And that shell kept a lot of people away for a very long time.
So how did you work on that self-love?
Look, it's been a journey, definitely a journey. One of the biggest things is a lot of time alone in nature. I traveled a lot. I mentioned my dad worked at the airport. So my dad worked for Qantas. And even though he had like the lowest low job in the catering department, we got discount flights. And so it was a beauty, you know, through my 20s and into my 30s, it was incredible. We had our own login portal. We could buy tickets like 10% the price. The tax was more than the ticket. You can only buy it 30 days before. So it was like, you know, last minute flights. It was incredible. I know a lot of people are envious of that, but that was the gift my dad gave me. And so I traveled a lot. I just spent a lot of time traveling around the world. I was deeply interested in understanding myself. So spirituality, I lived with a lot of indigenous cultures, read every spiritual text under the sun, you know, be it from the ancient Vedas to the Tao Te Ching, and, you know, obviously traditional Buddhism, Vipassana, Christianity, Judaism, Islam, you know, I just tried to, and then all of the, like, not all, but a lot of the weird ones too, you know, I tried to understand, like, what is this place? Who am I? So it was a lot of deep introspection, a lot of time alone in nature. When I was working as an adventure guide. So I was out in nature, taking people into nature, having a good time showing people around, and then just being by myself in nature. And I really got into yoga. So I was doing a lot of yoga, a lot of meditation. So it was just a lot of like inner work and just figuring myself out. And then come late 20s, I realized that the other people have to experience what I'm experiencing. And so I started to share and make videos on the internet and talk to people in the coaching industry. I started getting involved in that and, you know, started helping people in that arena as it was like in its infancy. And then as the internet started to boom by 2015, I had my own coaching business and just kept going from there. So I wanted to give back and show other people, but the journey never ends. Like, I still spend a lot of time with myself, do a lot of the inner work. Like, that's still my foundation. Yeah, so it's more just understanding who am I, because the more I get closer to that, what I was talking about at the beginning about the oneness and realizing myself as that oneness, it's love. Love is the foundation of reality. Love is the vibrational essence of God, Allah, Nirvana, the Tao, whatever it is that you want to call it. It's the only word that we have. I call it a capital L love. It's not like I love my wife, even. That's a little L love. That's still a material love, but a capital L love is the foundation of life. And so as I tap more into that feeling, that experience of who I really am, it becomes a lot easier to love this finite self, because I'm touching the infinite love. And if that's who I am, then this is who I am. It's one and the same. Okay, it becomes a lot easier to love myself. But it's not a it's not a logical concept. It's an experience.
Oh, so good. Yeah, I was going to ask you, you know, the difference between your love with a capital L and, say, romantic love, and you just went straight into it beautifully. So let's get, what would you say was your rock bottom moment as an adult?
Oh, geez, I've had a few.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, well, look, the one that really kick-started the journey is one I've told the story a few times. I'll make it as brief as possible. Long story short, at the end of high school, me and my dad had a really big falling out. By 14, I stopped listening to my father because he was telling me, be like me, boy. And I'm like, no, thanks. You know, and he was trying to guide me. He didn't know better. I'm the eldest. He's got this teenage boy who's strong in himself and he's trying to guide me and, you know, can be very heavy handed. That's the only way dad knew. And so I kept pushing back to the point where we had a fist fight. He was drunk. He's mildly attacked me and I just snapped and actually beat the shit out of my father. My brother had to pull me off. I black out. I used to fight a lot when I was a young fella. So I black out and go berserk. And then people stop me later and they're like, whoa, what just happened? I was like, I have no idea what just happened. So yeah, they call it berserker, like in the old Norse culture. I'd go berserk. So I'd bash my dad, broke his jaw, messed him up. After that, terrible relationship with my father. Had no guidance. We'd just left Cairns, moved to Brisbane when I was 16, and then went into grade 11. And by grade 12, I was just, didn't know who I was. I was playing the part. I become school captain. I was head of rituals and ceremonies. I was head of student representative committee. I was being mentored by the principal. I'm a great orator. I speak very well, always have done. So I'd speak on stage. Anytime there was like delegates, I'd give the speech and, you know, collared tie, you know, the collar with a tie and, you know, it was a posh Catholic school. So by day, I was like Batman. By day, I was like the, you know, the good kid. But in the darkness, I was listening to punk rock and like hating life. And me and dad didn't talk to each other, stalking the hallways. And then at the end of high school, I just went completely off the rails. I started breaking into cars, met some guys who were breaking into cars and stealing sunglasses and just stupid shit. And I started going to parties after high school. Mind you, I went into university and I was studying biotechnology and microbiology, science, you know. I wanted to be a scientist or something. I don't know what I wanted, but that's what they wanted me. And I just went off the rails and started getting into trouble till eventually I got arrested. It's going to happen. And I got 16 criminal convictions. But the worst thing is the guy who caught me physically, car chase through the back streets, ran my car. I was trying to break into his car. He came out of the house, smashed my mate with a pole, got my mate out of there, put him in the car, got out of there. He chased us, rammed us, got out, start swinging. I got an assault conviction against him for defending myself, but we were in the wrong. And then I was 18 at this stage. And then 15 months through court, I finally got sentenced. And after the hammer fell, we got a no recorded conviction. They said, look, you're good kids. You made a mistake. You know, I got references from my police sensei, my karate sensei, who was a police officer. So, you know, for 6 years, I trained under a SWAT team police officer. So he gave me this like a bravery medal winning SWAT team. So he gave me this like really great reference. My principal from school gave me a really great reference. You know, I actually started on the advice of the lawyer doing community service before the sentencing because they said they're going to give you community service. Start doing it now. So it was the one thing that brought me and my dad back together at that time because there was like conflict, there was struggle, you know, in the family. So that was a very big positive. But yeah, I'm leaving the courtroom, 16 criminal convictions, 150 hours community service. Don't do it again or I'll throw the book at you. It's like, oh my God, thank you so much. You know, no record, no jail time, nothing. Walking out and the guy who caught me 15 months earlier was standing there in a big leather jacket. I remember him on the phone. All I remember him saying is, yeah, they got off. Over the next week, he came to my house. He found out where I lived. He came to my house, threw a brick through the back window of my car, got my phone number, threatened to kill me, called me, threatened to kill me. Me and my dad went around to his car audio shop because he had a car audio shop. That's what we're trying to break into his car. He had some idea that through my ex-girlfriend's sister's boyfriend who managed a car audio chain, one of the shop in a chain, that I was part of some crime syndicate trying to put his small business out of business. And he had it out for me. He wanted to kill me. We went to the police. We put a restraining order on him. The next morning, I'm waking up to go. I'd finished a year and a half of university, and I quit that. That was never going to be for me. And I was on my way to work, and he called me in the morning and said, police just visited me. You'll be dead by this afternoon. Threatened to kill me. Broke a restraining order straight away, threatened to kill me. And he hung up, and I said to my dad, he just called me. This is what he said. And I said, what do I do? And dad said, you got two choices. One, I take you down now and you go into police custody, and you know, they'll whisk you away or do what they do, and you can fight it in court and, try and beat him. Or you can get on a plane right now and fly back to Cairns. Just get the hell out of here. I'll deal with it. And I was, 19 at this stage. And I said, far out, what do I do, dad? Like, what do I do? And he said, pack a bag, let's get out of here. So I literally, I called work. I was managing a Vodafone store. By this stage, I was in sales, managing a Vodafone store. I called them and I was like, look, I got to leave. They go, you got to tell us what's going on. And I said, I can't. I'm like, I don't want to tell you this shit. And they said, well, if you're leaving, you have to resign. So I faxed them a handwritten resignation there and then, packed a little carry-on bag. Dad put me in the garage on the back seat under a blanket, drove me to the airport, swiped in. This is, 20 something years ago, swiped in with his ID. He'd called ahead, drove in, walked me onto the plane, knows all the stewardesses, dad worked there, puts me in the seat, says to Jenny, take care of my boy. It's good luck, son. And then I arrived in Cairns a couple of hours later, and I remember that night was the night that absolutely changed my life. My auntie and uncle picked me up. They took me back to their place, and I said to my auntie Kathy, Uncle Bruce said, can I borrow your car? They're like, you okay? I'm like, not really. Can I borrow your car? I just want to like get out for a little bit. They said, yeah, borrow the car. So I drove out to what is now a very popular lookout in Cairns, but 20 years ago it was just a dirt track up a hill. Now they've paved it, and it's a beautiful lookout over the whole of Cairns called the Red Arrow. So I drove out, and it was on dusk. I hiked up, it's only half an hour, and then I sat out looking over Cairns, and I just broke down, Gemma, for like 2 hours, just cried and cried and cried, like, what just happened to my life? 2 years ago, I was giving the valedictorian speech at school, top of the school, and everybody loving me, and, top of the world. All your life ahead of you, you can do anything. Here I am 2 years later, nobody wants to invite me to a party because all I do is get in punch-ups. So I was so angry. Me and my dad don't talk to each other really other than through this drama. I now have 16 convictions and a dude just tried to kill me. I had to flee for my life under a blanket. What just happened to my life? And I started to backtrack and try and figure it out, what happened. And I, to end the story, I said I'd make it short, but you seem to be interested in it, so tell more details. But that night I backtracked and I tried to figure it out. And I realized that I was so unhappy because I was doing what everyone else wanted me to do. I didn't want to go to university, but I went to university because that's what they wanted me to do. I wasn't really interested in making money, although I was making really good money, in sales, managing the store. I was, top salesperson of Queensland and all this sort of stuff. I was making all this money and I was like, that's not really what I want to do, but I'm doing it because that's what society tells me to do. And all of these micro things, I just kept being pushed around by other people. Here I ended up, I was absolutely miserable. So I made a vow, not a decision. I made a vow that I would never do what anyone else wanted me to do ever again, that I was going to do what I wanted to do. And the second thing, as I realized, violence was destroying my life. I was very disciplined. I was very trained when I was in Cairns. I got my black belt. I was state champion 6 times. I fought in the Australian titles. I was a highly trained martial artist. And yet 2 years later, after leaving Cairns and leaving my sensei, I didn't have a great sensei. And I lost control of that controlled power that I was able to harness inside me. And it was manifesting itself in violence. Criminal convictions, bash my father, getting in the punch-ups, an assault conviction. And so I made a vow that day. I looked at my hands like this and I said, I will never lift my hands in violence again. And I have never lifted my hands ever. In my 20s, drunk at parties, I've had a couple of guys punch me and I look at them and I know that I could destroy them and I walk away. I've had that twice in my early 20s. Never lifted. I'm very proud of that because it was the one thing that was either going to make or break me. And so Well done, Scotty. You know, it's something that every man has to control to be able to know that you've got that energy inside you, but be able to control and direct it into positive ways. I think that's really important because this is about men, right? That's really important for men. But most importantly was that vow of I'm going to do what I want to do. And then back to that, I said to myself, well, what do I want? I said, I want to be happy. I said, well, what does that mean? I'm 19, Gemma, sitting on top of this mountain, you know, breaking down, like, oh, who am I? So I want to be happy because I'm absolutely miserable. What does happiness mean? I said, I don't know. I honestly don't know what happiness means. I said, well, what if I do all the things that I've always wanted to do? Maybe that'll make me happy. I said, okay, well, what do I want to do? And I said, well, I want to travel the world. I want to jump out of airplanes and go scuba diving and rafting, kayaking and rock climbing and all of these cool adventure. I grew up in Cairns, you know, it was all there for us. I want to do all of this stuff. And so I was like, yeah, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to do all this. I'm going to be happy. So I came down from there. I was late by this time. I went to bed, woke up the next morning, walked down to Kathy and Bruce. And they're like, are you okay? And I was like, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to be happy. I'm going to travel the world. I'm going to jump out of airplane. I'm going to do all this stuff. And they're like, you want to have breakfast first? My Uncle Bruce, such a smart ass. Hope he sees this one day. He's like, you want to have breakfast first? Like, yeah, okay, I'll have breakfast first. And then I told him what was going on and blah, blah, blah. They're really, really gracious, beautiful people, like second mum and dad. And he said, well, I just did a scuba diving course a couple of months ago. He went and got the business card and he said, there you go. I was like, done. I had plenty of money in the bank. I was like, cool. So I just become a scuba dive instructor. I did all my training, went out on the Great Barrier Reef and just started scuba diving. Realized that everyone in the world speaks two languages except for native English speakers. So I was like, I'm going to go learn some languages. So I moved to Japan because there's Japanese everywhere and I love Japanese culture. Cairns is full of Japanese. Now it's all Chinese, but back then it was all Japanese. So I moved to Japan, moved to Tokyo, started learning Japanese, and yeah, came back to Australia, went to Thailand traveling, came back to Australia, become a whitewater rafting. I was like, what's next? I know how to scuba dive, done 2000 dives. What's next? Whitewater rafting. Great. Started to become a whitewater rafting guide and just went from there. And I never looked back. I've just backed myself, just keep following my bliss and doing what makes me happy, hence all the adventure and all the travel. And I spent 20 years traveling around the world, just following my heart. That's it. You know, just follow my heart. Whatever I want to do, I do it.
So, I'd like you to talk, we'll backtrack to this violence piece, because as you said, we are talking to men, and there are men who are just like you were in that place where they're using their fists can you speak directly to those men and understand, because you understand where they are now, and can you speak to them? What message do you have for those men?
And I would say that it's not just men using their hands in violence, but there's a lot of verbal, emotional violence that is being used as well, especially in the online space. There's a lot more cowardice people. Back, you know, in my day, if I had a beef, I had to go and look that person in the face. And we had to deal with shit. Now you don't have to do that anymore. You can just troll people. You can talk shit about them on the internet. You know, there's a lot of like this undercurrent of violence, let's call it. So yeah, okay, to talk to the men directly, guys, I know that you don't mean to do it. I didn't mean to do it. I didn't want to hurt people, but I was hurting so much inside myself that I didn't have another outlet. It was like pressure in a bottle that had to be released. And the only thing that I saw, it's like a bull seeing red. I just saw other people that I would compare myself to. And I would think, well, I'm better than you. I'm stronger than you. You know, I'm this, that, or whatever it is that I'm feeling insecure about more than you. What's your problem? You know, and then I would start an argument and I would start a fight. It wouldn't always start with hands first. It would never start with hands first. It'd start by, you know, picking and picking and picking and picking and using the mouth and blah, 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 you know, and then getting in it. But my message to the guys is take a step back and realize that that person outside of you, whether it is someone that you want to get in fisticuffs with or someone that you want to talk shit about on the internet or you want to, you know, verbally abuse them or whatever, you're in your car and they're in their car next to them. Step back and check yourself, because it has nothing to do with those external circumstances. That person is the flag for the bull. It's got nothing to do with them. It has absolutely nothing to do with those external people. You've got to own it in yourself. You've got to look inside yourself and do the work to figure out who you are and what is up, what's wrong, what's going on inside yourself. Take an honest look. You don't have to spill that to a counselor or to somebody out on the street or, you know, on a video or to your loved one or whatever, you go and have a good chat with yourself. Go out into nature by yourself without any distractions. You know, when I was younger, it was a lot easier because we didn't have these phones. Leave your phone in the car, leave your phone at home, go walk about. Do what the Aborigines used to do. Go walk about, go disappear for a week in the bush. I used to just pack a pack and just hike. You know, there's some really great remote places that you can go in Australia that there's just nobody at. Find a water source that you can drink from so you can stay there a long time. Take a bag of rice and some, you know, some oil. That's pretty much all you need. And some salt. I've done that plenty of times. And just disappear and, you know, start a fire with a little pot and just go away. Or even if it's a day trip, maybe it's a couple of hours, whatever you need to do, go into nature by yourself and just be with yourself. I like taking a pen and paper and I'd write about stuff. I'd journal. I'd have no distractions, no music, no nothing. And men, you can heal the wounds from the past. Our family's been through hell and back. Our parents, our dads, our granddads, our uncles, you know, the other men in our lineage, they've been through very, very difficult times. You're probably going through a difficult time too. This time is not any easier than or harder than any other, but we have to do the work to own the shadow, that otherwise that shadow will come out and be a demon for other people. And that's not what we get to do anymore. The buck stops with us. The great awakening is happening. There is a change in consciousness and we are the ones that we've been waiting for. We are the ones that get to do this work to realize who we are. I liken it like this. My tissues is like a white cloth. Right. This is my wife uses the desk for sewing. It's like a white cloth. Right. And that white cloth is muddy and it's dirty. And I'm trying to live my life as a dirty cloth. At the core of it, it's a white cloth. At the core of this is white love, pure bliss. And all I've got to do is just keep washing away the mud, keep washing away the pain, keep washing away the fear. And I did this in an ayahuasca ceremony 2 weeks ago. I was literally cleaning my brain of muck, right? Of dirt, of pain, of fear, of all of this stuff. And all we're doing is we're wringing out the mud. And then it's a little bit cleaner. I'm a little bit clearer. I'm a little bit more like who I really am without all the muck, all the gunk, all the abuse, all the trauma, all the pain, all the fear, all the worry, all the stress, all the concern, all of this stuff that is tainting who I am slowly gets cleaned out. And every time I do the work, whether it's I'm in the men's circle and I'm checking in with the brothers, I did a lot of men's work and I recommend it for the men, whether I'm out in nature by myself and I'm sitting by the fire in the middle of nowhere for a week, just figuring myself out. You know, whether I'm journaling in the morning, whether I'm training at the gym, whether I'm doing martial art, whether I'm whatever it is, medicine ceremonies, reading spiritual texts, whatever it is for you to do the work. Every time you do the work, you clean yourself a little bit more until eventually all you're left with is a white cloth. All you are is pure white love, and that radiates through you. Because when you get the muck out, love can shine through. Because we are crystalline structures. We are water droplets, literally a water droplet. And if you see white light, sunlight go through a water droplet, you see the seven colors of the rainbow, right? That's how a rainbow is made. The water in the sky, when the white light, the rainbow is made. Red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet. It's the seven chakra. So literally all we are is white light moving through a crystalline structure that is the body, mind, and soul. And therefore we're cleaning the water. It's a dirty rainbow when it's not clear day, you know, you can only see maybe three colors, but when it's crisp and it's clear sky and you can see every color of the rainbow, you can see the lines between them. That's what we get to do with our body. Clean the body, clean the mind, let go of the fear. Ultimately, it's all about fear. Let go of the fear, let go of the fear, let go of the fear. Once the fear is gone and you're completely white and clear, and that white light can shine through, that will radiate the seven colors of the rainbow, which then reflects. They say it's all rainbow and unicorns. Yeah, no shit, it is. You know, it's all rainbows. You're literally refracting light and creating a rainbow mosaic that is called life. And then you get to live it Or you're living a mucky, dirty existence and you're trying to blame some other bloke outside of you for your pain and your shit, and he should have waited in line, when you've actually been the one white light, divine spirit moving through you, creating that mucky reality. So stop blaming your external reality and get back to the source of that creation. They say we are divine creators. Yes, white light shining through the crystalline structure of form is creating our reality. Go back to the form, clean the form so that that white light comes through as a pure rainbow, and then your life is rainbow and unicorns.
Awesome. Awesome, excellent message. Thanks, Scotty.
Make it a bit of fun.
How are Russian men different from, let's say, Australian men?
That's a question I have been pondering myself for many, many years. 6 years now since I met my wife. I've spent time with cultures all around the world. You know, I'm very well traveled. Obviously, as an adventure guide, I just got to deal with tourists every day, right? I speak three second languages, Japanese, Indonesian, and now Russian. I forget the other two mostly, unless I immerse myself again, because I don't use them. But the one thing that I would say about Russian men, there's a big craze at the moment around stoicism, the stoic philosophy, which is very centered, controlled emotionally, and able to focus and do what needs to be done, not very easily pushed or swayed off one's own course. That's the Russian man. Very stoic, very centered. It's a very hard life in Russia compared to the West. There's a saying that's getting more popular now. I see a lot of people posting it. Hard times make soft men. What is it? Hard times make weak men. Weak men make hard times. Hard times make strong men. Strong men make good times. Good times make weak men. Weak men make hard times, or something like that. I can't remember it now. Here it is. I've heard it so many times. But effectively, when you've got it too easy and too comfortable, you get soft. You know, if you sit on the couch all day eating buckets of ice cream because it tastes good, you're going to get soft. If you go and push and hurt yourself and struggle against those weights, you're going to get strong, right? And that goes emotionally, that goes spiritually, that goes in your relationships, that goes for everything. You need the struggle. You need the hard times in order to become strong. The Russians have had it hard, right? There was the takeover in 1917. Right, which was effectively a coup. They killed the Tsar, the king, and his whole lineage, his whole family, all his little kids. They killed all of them. Introduced Marxism, communism, right, from the Marxist philosophy. Very difficult times. Just like how many tens of millions of people were killed in Russia through, you know, over the next 20 years before the Second World War. Massive starvation, very, very difficult. That's grandparents' time. That's my grandfather, who just passed away at 94 at the start of the year. You know, he was around at the time when Russian peasants were starving on their own farms because all of the grain had to be sent away and they couldn't even keep enough to feed their families, let alone plant again next season. Very, very difficult times for our grandparents' era. Then the Second World War, a lot of people don't know how heavily affected Russia was in the Second World War. Right? It was pretty much Germany smashing Russia, trying to destroy Russia. And there's some stuff there to say, like, you know, that Hitler was actually trying to get rid of the communists. That's okay. Well, I'm not going to say anything that isn't on YouTube already. Okay. You can research this yourself. But they're pushing against the communism, right? And what is being the controlled around the world. So, but the Russians died. 24 million Russians died in the Second World War. That's almost the population of Australia today. And that was 70 something years ago, right? 80 years ago. That's a lot of people to die. So everybody here has the scarring of that Second World War, the starvation of that, the struggle of that. You came out of the Second World War and you were still in communist times, where you worked and you worked and you worked and you got just enough to get by. right? This is not US baby boomer, post-World War II reserve currency, Australia, England, and Europe riding on the back of the US dollar hegemony, right? Like, this is not prosperity for all. Buy a house and sit on it and you're going to be a millionaire or, you know, wealthy by the time you retire just because you worked a postal job or a normal job and you bought a house. We had abundance. These guys here, post-Second World War, struggled their asses off. Coupled with the fact that it's freezing cold, you know, like, it's hard to live here. For 5 months of the year, it's under snow. So the Russian man is a worker. The Russian man keeps his head down, gets the job done, and helps each other, sticks together. The communist government was very authoritarian, as we see in China, right? It was only in 91 that, 90 to 92, call it 91, that this thing collapsed. I was almost a teenager, you know, like, when this is, these guys are still under this control. They keep their head down. They help each other. The police are good to each other. I've been let off by the police here several times. Like, I remember in the 80s with my dad, you know, police pulling over my dad in the 80s in small town Cairns, back before it was a big tourist destination, small town Cairns, going, all right, mate, just head straight home and, you know, just don't do it again. You know, not today in Australia, you can't get away with that anymore, right? Here, I'm driving down the street here with my son on my lap, driving 5 minutes to take him to the creek for a swim in summer a few months ago. And I come, it was Monday morning, and I come around the corner and the police are on this back street corner checking people doing like breathalyzer. They don't have the thing. They just ask you, have you been drinking? And they smell you. But like checking people Monday morning because it was a some big holiday celebration the day before. And it's like, I'm like, mate, I'm so sorry. I know I shouldn't be doing this, but we live there. I've got to cross this road to get to the creek. We live 5 minutes from the creek. And he's, where are you from? He's from Australia, blah, blah, blah. And I said, mate, if it was dangerous, I wouldn't do it. That's my boy. You know, I'm not going to hurt my four-year-old son. And he's like, all right, mate, you know, like, chuck him in the seat. Don't do it again. You know, you'll get out of here. You're all good. It's like, far out. You know, that's, he's a man. He's not a policeman first. He's a man. He's a father. He's another guy living his life in this reality without the ego that has been bashed into them, which is what's happened to the police in the West. And I grew up with police. You know, I've trained at the police youth club. My sensei was a police officer. My senpai were police officers. You know, like, I know the police, but today's police are not what they were. Today's police, those, they are not men anymore. They're men in uniforms, and the uniform comes first. Here, they're real people. They stick together. They help each other. They look after each other. You know, we don't have that in Australia. The neighbors help each other. They support each other. We're almost finished building our house in a village, in an eco-village. My neighbor over this way, he built my foundation. The other guy down here is where we get our milk from. And the fella over this side, he's my builder. And his three boys that work with him, they live in the village as well. You know, like, everybody's in it together. They all look after each other. My neighbor next door is my electrician. You know, he's doing my wiring. The neighbor over here, he's the bloke that I borrow everything from because I don't have a lot of the gear. You know, they all stick together. They help each other. Like the good old days of Australia, it's the reality today. Traditional men are men, women are women. Women wear long flowing skirts and have beautiful long hair. You know, no offense to anyone that wants short hair. It's up to you, whatever you want to do. But there's this femininity to the women. There's this masculinity to the men. All the men, they all shake hands with each other. You know, they say hello to the ladies. They'll shake hands like my grandfather's days in England when he grew up in England. You know, men are men, women are women. They've got these laws against, you know, propaganda, trans propaganda, which I absolutely agree with here. You can be gay, they're like, you can be gay, that's totally fine, but you cannot propagandize your ideas in our traditional society. And they have a law against it. No drag shows for toddlers, you know, the stuff they're doing in the US. So that's a long story to explain what I reckon about the Russian men. I've got a lot of respect for them. Now, there is some drinkers. That's the sign for drinkers. There's some people that have got some alcohol problems here because there is a lot of pain and a lot of suffering because it is very, very difficult still. The economy is very, very like weak compared to the Western economies, although that's going to change very quickly and already is. But there is drinkers. So you've got to watch them sometimes because you'll see like outward drunks out there on the street. So sometimes you have to be a bit careful. But the average guy who's living his life, you know, working and taking care of family, whatever, solid, look you in the eye. What you see is what you get. No mask, no deep demons that you got to worry about. Just like straight up, what you see is what you get. So I like it.
Yeah, I love this. That was a great sort of explanation of, the sort of the, as you said, the traditional masculine feminine, where men are, masculine men and women are
Definitely.
feminized women. Have you got
Yeah.
anything more to say on this subject? Because, you're living in the middle of a whole society, a whole country of it there. It's not just something that, like one couple in the middle of America that are, wanting to live that way. How does it benefit the community as a whole? And what else have you got to say about that?
I'm glad. I don't know how much time we got. I keep wondering if we're rambling too much, but if you're
Well,
asking
we've got
questions, I'm
about
answering.
35 minutes left, and I want,
Oh, perfect.
the
Bang
conversation.
on.
I want nothing left unsaid. So let's start with that and then
Bang.
take the conversation, whatever you feel
Yeah,
is important to
perfect.
bring into it.
Perfect. I'm used to the 60 minutes. This is great. We got some time to have a chat. Look, I think it's absolutely essential to have traditional gender identities in men and women. I think it's absolutely essential. We see it in all creation. Every life form, well, life forms that reproduce with a masculine and feminine, I'm not talking about amoebas who split themselves, whatever. Like I'm talking about, a tree has a masculine and feminine parts to it. Every animal has a masculine and feminine. They're not confused about their roles in that relationship. And yet we have been systematically brainwashed and manipulated through our education system, through the media, through good old Walt Disney, since we were little kids. I really didn't know this. I take a second look at it now. We have been systematically destroyed in our own identity because if you don't know who you are, you're going to start asking questions. And the people who control the media and the people who control government policy, the education system itself, the training of those teachers, they all have that agenda to completely destroy us. So when you're completely confused and you don't even know if you're a man or a woman, or even what that means, or I'm a woman now in the feminist movement and I have to fight against all the men because all the men are bad now, that was a psyop. When I was younger, I thought it was great. I thought feminism was like, yeah, cool, good on you ladies. It's about time. We all thought that. Now I look at it and I'm like, wow, the women that have been, they've been jibbed. They've been absolutely jibbed. Now you got to work 50 hours a week, and your husband has to work 50 hours a week, and your kids are in, oh, how convenient. They're either looking at media on their iPads because you're too bloody busy to do it or too exhausted to be with them, or they're stuck in an educational system where they're taught to sit down, shut up, do what you're told. Hey, by the way, blah, propaganda, brainwash, 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 be a good little slave. So this women's rights movement absolutely destroyed the family unit and absolutely destroyed people as we are today. So there was no positivity in that whatsoever. I agree that we needed to find a way for us to all have what it is that we desire, but not by tricking women into thinking that they have to pull on their big boy pants and get out there and be a masculine man in a masculine world in a business environment. These corporate ladies who want to wear the power suits and crush it against the men. This is the idea that we've seen through the media to be the ideal strong woman. And yet they've lost themselves. Women are feminine. Women every month are rising and falling in emotion like the moon. Your mentor, I did a great podcast. If anyone's interested, I'm going to quick podcast plug scottyz.com or go to your podcast player and search for Awaken Freedom with Scotty Ze. Just search Scotty Ze in any podcast or YouTube, whatever on there. There's an interview I did with Bell Tozer, Belle. Just put Bell, Scotty Ze, Bell Tozer, it'll come up, talking about women's moon cycles and how much you're affected, and therefore how much men are affected by women's moon cycles, right? Because we're in it with you. And how disconnected women are from the actual like life circuitry that you are tapped into, that 28-day menstrual cycle, that moon cycle that you're tapped into. If you're in a certain phase of the moon, it's a time for going inward, not Wednesday 10 a.m. board meeting, crush, kill, and destroy. Ladies, you're hurting yourself physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually by grinding in a man's world, competing against men, and being completely disconnected from who you really are. And then these women are rising up and putting on the big boy pants, blaming men for their toxic masculinity because a man is being doing his best to be a provider, to protect, to serve, to take care of these women, because that's what we do. If somebody comes into my door, I'm the one that's getting out there and fighting off five guys while my wife is holding our son in the bedroom, locked in the bathroom or something. I'm the protector. I'm the one that's going to get out there and take care of business, that's going to get the stuff done. And my wife is very happy to be in the home, making everything beautiful, taking care of us, cooking amazing food, nurturing our son who's sick at the moment, got a flu or something. You know, being that provide, being that nurturer, I provide the outside, I bring the outside to the inside, and I go, oh, there you go, love. And she's like, oh, abundance, right? Boom, 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 boom. Let's make that. Let's take care of that. Let's make that beautiful. Oh, there's some excess. Cool. Let's make the place more nice. Oh, I bought this chandelier thing or whatever it is. You know, I prettied it all up. There's, you know, feathers and little blue things in the nest, whatever. You know, the wife is actually bowerbirds. I think it's the man that makes the blue things so that attracts the woman. But either way, she takes care of the inside of our life, inside our family. And when we go out into the world, I'm the one that's carrying the sword and the shield, because it's a rough world out there. I'm the one that's got the strength to face down the army and protect the castle. That's my role. And yet the women now are going, no, that's my role too. Why? Because they told you that shit on TV? Because that's what the teachers told you in school? And all of a sudden you're going to get out there and battle against the other dickheads out there? You don't want to compete in that world, but you've been told that that's how you have to be free and independent. You equal. Know, you've been equal, right?
That's equal, yeah.
What a load of shit. And it's completely destroyed the dynamics of a relationship. So the men are becoming more masculine. The women are becoming more masculine. The men are becoming demasculated. They're becoming more feminine. And it's completely fucking up their sex life as well, right? Like, there's no connection. There's no polarity. Magnetic poles have to have an opposite polarity in order to create the magnetic field that pulls it together. If you've got a weak man in his feminine and a sort of a half woman trying to compete in the big boys world, who's never going to be a man, I don't care what operation they're doing these kids these days, which is just disgusting. You're never going to have the polarity. Therefore, your family unit will always be weak, because you need the strength of the polarity to keep the family unit intact. And that's something for me and my wife that we're focused on, is keeping that polarity. My wife is downstairs right now doing whatever my wife does during the day, right? I work, I like it, it's what I enjoy. She's got hobbies and she's got a tea business actually she's building as well, but not for any need other than that's what she loves to do. And she wants to do that, right? She doesn't have to compete out there and make it profitable and do all of this sort of stuff, because that's what I do. And I think that that's how the world is meant to be. She takes care of our son. I say, right, guys, I'm going to work, right? And I walk upstairs to the spare room. That's where I work, you know, thankfully. But she's with my son. She takes my son to swimming practice and, you know, to kindy. And I pick him up when I can and go to swimming practice. And obviously, I've got a lot more freedom than the average guy because I work for myself. So I can do those sort of things. But she is mostly taking care of the family unit. And I'm out there being the man of the house. That's how it's meant to be. That's how we harmonize best together. That's how women can feel most loved and nurtured, that they, you know, and it's not about having to attach themselves to a man. But I tell you, when there is a strong, confident, capable man, a man, women are naturally attracted to that man. They want to be with that man. They want to be taken care of by that man. They want to be nurtured by that man. And therefore, for us as men, we're like, I want to take care of you more. I want to nurture you more. I want to grow more abundance for our family to give you more, right? I want that. Yes, have another child because we've got that abundance that I've brought in. That makes me more of a man. That's what we want. We want that pull between us, both for the sake of the woman and the sake of the men's own growth, and therefore the sake of the family unit. It's absolutely essential. We need it now. So get away from the lies that they're telling you on the TV and the media and this transgender agenda. It's a lie. It's a manipulation. And I feel sorry for anybody that's going through it. And I have friends that their kids have gone through it. And even one, a dear friend from school who their child has had an operation because of this agenda. And I say there is something wrong with that. That's not normal. I'm not going to normalize that. I'm not going to pretend that that's normal. I have empathy and care. I have a lot of compassion for anybody, and especially my friend and their child going through that. I have empathy and compassion, but I'm not normalizing it. I believe there is something wrong with it. And I don't believe, I know in my bones that there's something very wrong with it. I'm not going to make any excuses for it. I'm just going to do my best to share my point of view and my truth and stand with other people to feel the same way. Because the future is bright for those that have got the eyes open to see the lies and manipulation now and are willing to band together to help each other to get through the dark road. They say, if you're going through hell, keep going. Don't stop. Right? That's where we're at. We're going through hell. The devil is trying to make us stay in hell. We're not staying. We're leaving. We're out of here. Keep going, band together, help each other get through. And the other side is a very bright future.
Scotty, are some men more naturally aligned with the feminine pole? Are you saying that all men should be in this fully masculine energy, or is there room for feminine energy within some men or all men? Does it fluctuate? Can you speak on that, please? And does the heart come into that? Because the heart is being a feminine energy.
So if you look at the way that the planet is, right, we've got the North Pole, we've got the South Pole, we've got an equator. Now, there's actually potentially, there's only a middle, and it's actually a flat Earth. And, you know, the sun goes around and around and around, the moon goes around. We don't actually know. We've been lied to enough. We're in the state. We don't actually know what it's like. But there's different seasons in different areas, right? Like I grew up in the equatorial belt in Cairns, right, far north Queensland. There, the fluctuations between the winter and the summer were very minuscule. You know, it might be, I don't know how much it was, an hour difference, 2 hours max, maybe it's three, I don't know, but it's not much. You know, like it swings just a little bit. So you could say, like, if the daytime or the summertime is the masculine and the nighttime and the wintertime is the feminine, then there was, you know, sort of an equal balance between the two. If you're dead on the equator, right, you're spot on the equator, there's no change. It's 50-50, always. 12 hours of sunlight, 12 hours of daylight, of night, all year round, right? But the further that you move away from the equator, like where I am now, I'm very far north. 21st of December will be the solstice. We'll have about 6 hours of sunlight. That's a lot of darkness. That's a lot of 18 hours of darkness, right? Dark, cold, feminine. Fair, a lot of feminine here. Now, is being equal in the equator better? Is winter with its 18 hours of darkness worse than summer with its 18 hours of sunlight? You know, is one better than the other? You can't have the abundance of life here in winter. Now, you see it in the equator, it's just tropical. But here where I am, summer, oh my God, you should see stuff grow. You can't stop things growing. Like, I'll whippersnip and I'll come back the next day and there's new growth. I'm like, holy Jesus, I just whippersnipped this thing yesterday. You know, like in Australia, you whippersnip or mow something, then you come back 3 weeks later and you're like, yeah, I probably should give it another mow. I think I could see a little bit of growth on it. You know, like you're mowing the lawn just to pick up the leaves from the trees. You know, you don't even hear. Oh my God, summer is incredible. My wife's garden, you know, I do the prep work. She does the planting and takes care of it. And I harvest it, masculine, feminine. I do the heavy lifting. Mate, the stuff that she grows, we've got shelves downstairs that pickled this and pickled that. And we have to buy another freezer for all the berries that are coming off all the plants. We walk through the forest, pick berries. Abundance in summer. That growth is only possible because the amount of snow load in winter freezes all of the bacteria, freezes all of the parasites, all of the things that would destroy that much life if it was trying to grow. That much water, that snow soaking into the top layer of the earth gives that abundance to rise. You can't have that abundant growth without the winter. The beauty of winter, the crispness of the air, how clear the night sky is. You don't get that. You get the haze a little bit in summer because of the, I was going to say a Russian word, vlazhna, the humidity, right, in the sky. You don't see that. You see the beauty, the coating light from the solar system is coding us in a different way in winter, right? Like there's a difference to it. So back to your point, just to sort of tap there into nature and how nature works, some people are born in the equator. Some people are naturally more inclined to the northern or the far southern climates. Some people love winter. My barber, this is a Russian haircut, by the way. Everyone sort of teases me, all the Aussies, like, this is a Russian haircut. This is a Russian haircut. My barber hates summer. He grew up in far north Siberia, right? Further than us northeast, Siberia straight away. Hates summer. He says winter is the best. Can't get enough of winter. I love winter. As soon as it hits, like, starting to get cold, hits 0 degrees, I come alive. You're crazy. Who are you? Now, is it my place to say, mate, you need to be more summer? Because that ain't right. More summer is the only way to go. No, of course not. I can't say to people in the tropics, hey, you got to come and check out winter. My mates in Australia are like, you're crazy. It's freezing. It's like, yeah, dude, but I'm going snowboarding. I'm going skiing. You know, I walked across the lake. I've got a lake in front of my house. I walked across the lake and it's frozen solid. You got to check this out. You got to see how beautiful it is. You know, like, it's a different world. So it's not that for masculine and feminine that men have to be more than another, but the seasons change. You can't have the night without the day. You can't have the winter without the summer. Every man has a feminine aspect. It's how we're able to relate to each other. It's how we're able to actually go inside ourselves. If we were all masculine all day, I'd just be working. I'd just be going like a train. You know, I'd never have that inner time, that night time, that self-reflection, that inner, you know, I wonder what life is all about. You know, that pondering of who I am. I need those aspects. And women the same, you know. If women were just completely feminine all the time, shit, mate, the dishes need to be done, love. You know, like, can you please, like, pick up around the house or something? You know, I don't mind you hanging around all day, but, you know, do you mind doing a couple of things? If that'd be really helpful. You know, like, we've got to have that balance inside of us, but there's naturally going to be a balance in different people. There's going to be some men that are more feminine inclined, you know, more that have that more feminine aspect, maybe more wanting to be in the healing arts, maybe more want to be in, like, caring for others, nursing, doctors, you know, counselors, stuff like that. There's more masculine, you know, you meet some of the boys, and they're the ones that are swinging, how big can you swing the sledgehammer and go, oh, look how far I can wee up the tree. You know, they're masculine, and you try and have a feminine conversation with them, and they're just like, what are you talking about, mate? All right, yeah, you obviously grew up in the summer. You know, you don't get the winter at all. And some blokes are more into winter, but there's always a balance. There's always, not one is better than another, but if you're artificially creating nature, which is what they're doing with geoengineering now, if you're artificially creating in nature a winter or a summer season, a rain season like Australia's happening with the flooding, when it's not meant to be there, if you're externally manipulating nature and you're causing it to be something other than it's meant to be in its divine essence, that's when you're playing God, but it's not God, it's the devil, because you shouldn't mess with God. You know, they're playing with the devil, and they're hurting people. They're hurting nature. They're hurting it. So they're hurting these little boys and these little girls. They're hurting these men and these women because they don't know who they are. They've been told to be a certain way. Always listen to authority. The doctor knows better. The teacher knows better. Mum and dad know better. The policeman knows better. You do what you're told and be a good person and life will be perfect for you. Okay. You know, and all of a sudden they're just completely confused with who they are. It's the same as the weather engineering is hurting people. So be who you are in your divine self. But we're so far away from that because generationally we have been confused. Generationally we have been manipulated. That, again, the buck stops with us. We have to do the inner work. We've got to drink the medicine. We've got to do the meditation. We've got to figure ourselves out in nature, back in the animal state of who we are. We've got to go through the work to get out of the mud, like I spoke about, stuck in the mud. You've got to get out of the mud. You've got to clean the mud out of yourself. We've got to do the work to even realize who we are and realize the level of manipulation. So even saying right now, like, oh yeah, I agree with you, Scotty. I guess I'm more naturally feminine. Well, are you? I'm a go-getter. I'm a businesswoman. Oh, that's who I am in my core. Well, really? Have you done enough self-inquiry and cleaned away enough of the garbage, the fear, the social conditioning to actually get back to who you are at your essence? Because when you get there, you'll know yourself, know thyself. That was on the Matrix. I used to carry that with me at the Oracle's office, the kitchen of the Oracle, when Neo met the Oracle. Know thyself. I used to take it everywhere I travel and I stick it above the door of my bedroom, right? Know thyself. Once we know thyself, to know who we are at our true self, life gets a lot easier. You're not living in concepts anymore. You're not living in any sort of manipulated construct reality. You're living from who you truly are, from source. So that's the work that needs to be done. Then we'll have a conversation.
Good, great. Okay, so you touched on plant medicine, yoga, and meditation as tools and practices you'd used yourself on your healing journey. Now, would you like to dedicate maybe 5 minutes to each and talk about, because to, I mean, plant medicine I've never done, yoga and meditation, big tools for me too. So please speak to these three things, talk to men, and just give the basics of how they might be able to, if it appeals to them, integrate it into their healing journey.
Yeah, beautiful. Yoga came to me because after I made the vow to never lift my hands in violence again, I stopped training fighting martial arts. And I was very, very active before that. After karate, I got into Western boxing, then kickboxing, and then kung fu. And I really enjoyed them. But when I was like, no more violence, I couldn't bring myself to punch and kick anymore for 8 years anyway, for until I was 28. Then I started training martial art again. So I got into yoga at that time. Because I started getting into meditation mostly, meditation led me to yoga. Meditation I learned through a teacher on stage. I went to a weekend seminar. This is Jesus, I was 20 years old, going to a weekend seminar from this guy, Michael DiMacchio role, and he passed away a couple of years ago. He was my first sort of mentor in that space. So I started getting into yoga, and I really took to yoga because it was very much like martial art. Because obviously in martial art, we do a lot of stretching. You know, we want to be limber, we want to be open, so be able to kick high and kick strong. And when you're working with people, karate was less. We did a little bit of manipulations like jujitsu, but not much. But we did a lot of stretching and a lot of body movement. So yoga I took to very naturally because it was like martial art. Now, talking to the men out there, if you thought that yoga was like for women in tight pants, well, you should go and check it out because those tight pants look really good. Just saying, from a guy to a guy, go and check it out. Go and stand at the back of the yoga class, and you might change your mind. Just saying,
Even if that's the only thing that gets them to yoga,
it
right?
gets you going. Yeah, whatever it is, just don't wear tight pants yourself, lads. Just saying, just in case. But go and check it out. It is yoga is so many different things. Right, so many different things. It's not just the vinyasa flow, in breath, out breath. Like yoga can be hard. Go and do Ashtanga vinyasa. That was my specialty. Ashtanga vinyasa is hard. It's like shaking the body hurts. Three more breaths, hard, like very hard. Or do like a deep yin opening where you think you are going to break. Like, is this real? Like, is my body going to hold up here? It can be very, very difficult. And then it can be flowing as well. You can have lots of different sorts. But yoga to me, Bruce Lee had this thing about he studied all of the different martial arts to the point where there was no longer any boundary between any arts nor the movement itself. So the whole Bruce Lee thing was about being formless. I studied Jeet Kune Do for quite a few years and then went on to study Wing Chun, which was his original martial art, right? And it gets to a point, and it comes from Wing Chun originally, and then he created his own, that there's no, this is not a punch and this is not a block, right? There's movements between all movements that it becomes fluid and one. So this is what we want to do with movement practice as well. Getting beyond it being yoga asana, where this is this asana or this stance, and this is this posture, and this is this, and this is this, and this is this, and this is this, till it becomes a complete flow and a movement. So that's what I more practice now. So to me, my martial art with, kung fu, karate, harder style, with yoga, with tai chi, a little bit that I've done, with qigong, a little bit that I've done. All and dancing. I love to dance, right? I'm a big dancer. Salsa, I love dancing, but I love free dancing. Like, I lived in Bali for 5 years, And the ecstatic dance in Bali is just bliss for me. I love it. Close my eyes and just move my body. So for me, they all flow together now, where there's hardness, there's softness, there's rhythm, there's flow, there's opening, there's contracting. Like it all flows in this own beautiful movement. And for me, that is martial art, right? That is martial art. You've got to be formless. Like Bruce Lee says, be like water. You pour water in a cup, it takes the shape of the cup. You pour water in a teapot, it takes the shape of the teapot, right? In life, we have to be formless. I can walk into any situation anywhere in the world and I will immediately fit in. And I'm talking like me being in Bali, hanging out with like the poorest of the poor Javanese who are literally living on white rice and not even enough of that, sitting down cross-legged and eating white rice with them. And then not a long time later, hosting a business retreat with, you know, 7 and 8 figure entrepreneurs and being in that, you know, fine dining experience. Like, I don't mind. I am like water. I will be anywhere. I'll walk down any street in any neighborhood, you know, back streets of LA, been there, done that, you know, to back streets of Russia, you know, been there, do that every day. I don't care. I don't mind. I feel very comfortable with myself because I know who I am and I can walk through with confidence without being threatening to anybody, nor being threatened by anybody. And so for a man, having the ability for your body to be adaptable, yoga is a really great framework for that. But as I'm saying, find the martial art within that. So couple it with whatever practice you're doing. If a man is not training martial art, go and train martial art. Learn how to defend yourself and the ones that you love. You may never have to use it. As I said, I've never had to use it. I've never hit anybody. I've had to restrain some people before, not on my own behalf, but for other people. Like if there's shit going down, I always run in and I sort shit out. That's just who I am, right? I'm trained. That's what I do. Like if there's a car accident, I run in and I do CPR and first aid. And, you know, I've had a guy die in my arms because I'm trained. You do that much adventure guiding, you're going to get good at it. You know, like I'm comfortable in those situations. So I'll go in and sort it out, but I've never had to fight anybody. I've never had to punch anybody. I've had to block a couple of punches, but I've never hit anybody, never kicked anybody. I haven't done that in 20 years, thankfully, other than somebody holding a bag, you know, like training. But because I know what I'm capable of and I'm comfortable in my own skin. For every man to have that ability, that no matter where you go, your wife and your kids, shit starts going down, you radiate an energy where people leave you alone, where people don't want to mess with you. Where you can walk down the street and people will come out and a weaker man will be like, you know, or a man that doesn't know his own capability. And people like it might, that would be the energy, whether he's doing it physically. And I was like, oh, I'm just going to walk. You know, the predators can smell the weakest in the pack. You know, they can identify the weakest in the pack and they will attack the weakest in the pack. There are predators out there. So men, get strong in your body. Use yoga as a way to get stronger in your center. Use martial art coupled with yoga. And if you love to dance, put it in there too, baby, because Bruce Lee was one of the best dancers there is, man. That guy could dance. You got to dance, man. You got to flow. You got to move. It's part of the deal. Bring that movement practice. So beyond yoga, bring a movement practice that is centered in a martial way for a man so that you have that strength and confidence inside yourself. Moving into meditation, or you want to keep flowing, or you got any questions
on
that?
Go for it. Go. Meditation. Yep.
Meditation is the same as the external martial arts, but it's for the inside. It's for the mind, right? It's so that the mind can be so strong and centered in itself that it can't be thrown off track when there's things going on. It can't be manipulated when they're telling you there's a deadly virus traveling around the world trying to kill everybody. The mind is not going to be pulled into those manipulations any more than the body would be pulled into any conflict physically, right? The mind is centered. The mind knows who it is. It knows what it's capable of. I'm able to focus my mind, like I'm able to focus my body on a certain path. I choose the path that I walk, whether it's the back streets of LA or Russia or whatever, right? Anywhere around the world, I will go there. I will be there. We're about to go to Egypt in a few weeks. Very exciting. Getting out of winter, just so you know. You know, like I get to live that life, I get to walk that, but my mind is the creative aspect, the body is the tool that I implement these things. So meditation allows me to take control of the greatest tool and weapon that I have in this reality, And that is the ability to imagine what I want my life to look like and then see it so clearly that the golden path to get there starts to illuminate itself. And the more that I can focus my attention on that singular goal, the clearer the path of light gets. You know, when you look at a light and you squint a little bit at the light at nighttime and you can see the rays of light that go through to your eye, that's the same thing that we're doing with our mind. So when we focus so solely on that point of light in the future, in our imagination, the life that we want to live or situation, and we squint, meaning we focus and we focus and we focus and we focus enough on that, the little ray of light joins our current reality to the reality of the imagination of where you want to go. But you have to hone it.
Are you using meditation as a, like the traditional meditation to, you know, sort of, well, I know you can't stop thinking, but, you know, empty your mind or come into your heart? Or, because I do this too, are you using meditation as a means to amplify manifestation, like what you were just talking about? Are you doing that in meditation, or are you, which meditation are you doing?
No, meditation to me is traditionally, it's no and yes, I do both. Sorry, I should answer that to clear that up. But yes and no, meditation is different to imagination. I will imagine in or on the backside of a meditative experience. But meditation to me is like what you're saying is about just coming into my center. I do the traditional like Vipassana meditation, which is I'll concentrate first on the air moving in and out of the feeling of the nostrils until such a point where I settle down the mind, because, you know, I'm a guy and a life form. I'm a human, you know, I'm busy, I'm doing stuff, I'm juggling a million things at once, you know. So I'll use the breath to come into the center. I sit cross-legged. I had done since I was 20, and I think it's the better way than sitting in a seat. I sit cross-legged and I'll use the breath here until my mind comes in, and then I'll feel the sensations of my face and then start going through my head, and I'll just feel the sensations of my body. I'll just go through my whole body. So that's just complete, like no mind. Yeah. And then I will do imagination. So then, like after that, different times before, while I'm laying down, going to bed, Neville Goddard style. I don't know if you've seen Neville Goddard. Guys, you got to go check out Neville, N-E-V-I-L-L-E, God, Art, G-O-D-A-R-T. That's actually his last name. Cool name. He's got these about imagination, right? Beautiful, amazing teacher, well past, like is in the 30s or 50s or something like that, maybe the 70s, I don't know. But at night, you know, laying down in bed before you sleep and then imagining the future that you want and then drifting off to bed while imagining that reality. So that imagination, but you can't have the clear imagination without having control of the mind. Because otherwise, when you go to do the imagination, you're like, right, I've got to do that tomorrow. Right, I've got to think about that. Oh, I was thinking about that before. And blah, 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 blah. He's like, whoa, I'm imagining my future. I'm just trying to hold this one bloody picture of my dream home or my dream life or whatever my dream thing is. I'm trying to hold this picture, but my mind is all over the place. It ain't going to happen. So number one is the meditation, no mind, bringing it back into the breath, bringing it back into the sensations of the body, slowing it all down, being very present. Great, that's meditation. And that is essential, absolutely essential. And if you do it in nature, it's a lot easier too. I talked to guys before about going into nature. Go into nature, do it in nature. That's where you want to be doing it.
So good. Okay. Plant medicine. 5 minutes.
Okay. Got it.
We can go over if you want. I mean, we can extend this interview a bit because I don't want anything left unsaid. But can we dedicate 5 minutes?
My throat is almost done too. I can feel it.
All right. Well, you did this will be the last one. Plant medicine. Let's get into it a little deeper. Is it for all men? What do you say to men about plant medicine?
Do it. Drink it. As much as you can, not as much as you can, but absolutely. The only thing I would say in that is if you have some sort of clinical mental diagnosis, like you have bipolar disease. And look, I'm not one to label things, but there is people that are labeled and connect with those labels. And I'm sure that there's some merit to those labels in some cases, right? It's like if you can name it and you can look at it, then maybe you can do something about it, right? So there are people that have clinical depression or that have bipolar disorder or have schizophrenia, stuff like that. In that case, I would be very careful in doing anything that will change and alter your state, only because I have no idea about that world whatsoever, right? For everybody that has a normal functioning consciousness, please do the research. Have a look at the power of DMT, dimethyltryptamine, what we call the spirit molecule. There are lots of different plant medicines. The one that I connect mostly with is Natem or ayahuasca, a couple of different names for it, depending on what tradition you come from. Traditionally, it's mixed with a root. A vine that climbs and a leaf. The leaf has the DMT molecule in abundance. Now, DMT, dimethyltryptamine, is in every cell of every living organism. Every cell of your body, every cell of every plant has DMT molecule inside of it. When you are born, there is a spike of DMT. This is clinically studied. There's a spike of DMT from your pineal gland, which is inside of here, right? There's a spike of DMT the moment that you're born. Boom. There's a spike of DMT through the body the moment that you die. So what it is believed is that the DMT is what is, it's why it's called the spirit molecule, actually the connector for spirit to enter the body and be in the body. So when you're born, boom, DMT, spirit connects into the body, body-mind complex, right? When you die, the spirit is able to leave the body, yeah? So every cell has that DMT. Now, in ayahuasca, the leaf has the spirit molecule, the DMT, in abundance. But if you just cook it up and eat it, there's an enzyme in the gut that digests the DMT, and you just poo out the leaf and job's done. So the root has an enzyme inhibitor in it. So they cook the vine, which they say is the masculine and the leaf is the feminine, right? They cook them together for 8 hours, boil, bubble, 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 boil, just sit, water, vine, leaf, blah, 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 blah. Cut it all up, fine, put it in, bubble, 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 8 hours, right? Boils down, and depending on the strength of it, how much water was in there, you'll drink a shot glass, half a shot glass, usually not much more than that, maybe a little bit bigger, but usually a shot glass or half a shot glass. So it's not much, right? They say you got to drink 20 liters of it to die. You drink 20 liters of water, you're going to die. You know, like, it's so you have a shot glass, no problems. From my understanding, nobody's ever died from drinking ayahuasca. Maybe some people have died from being stupid on ayahuasca, like doing it when they don't have a proper facilitator or a shaman there to support the process so that you don't like run and jump off a building or something. But in terms of like drinking, it's a medicine. It's not a poison. It's a medicine. You drink it. The enzyme inhibitor stops the enzyme in the gut. The DMT is then able to be digested into the body. It takes about 45 minutes to an hour, depending on the strength, sometimes sooner, sometimes longer, for then you to start to feel the initial effects. The initial effects that I usually feel is the body starts to change, like a little bit. It's not tingling, but it's like different sensation. And when I like squint or blink, I start to see the fractals, the fractal patterns. And it goes from anywhere from 4 to 7 hours. Sometimes you'll drink a second cup, sometimes a third cup, if you're really courageous or stupid like me back in the day. You know, now I'm happy to have one cup and it's usually enough, sometimes a second cup, but you know, when I was a bit younger, like, let's go, drink as much as you can. But usually have one, maybe two, maybe three cups. It's 4 to 7 hours. Then you're very tired. You do it at nighttime traditionally. So everything's blacked out. Here we drink it about 10 o'clock at night. Other places I've drunk like just on sunset. In Australia, I did a lot on sunset. And then from there you rest afterwards. But the experience itself is absolutely incredible. The spirit molecule, because every cell has the molecule, there's heaps of research on YouTube, on Rumble. You can go and watch videos about how ayahuasca works. But the spirit molecule, because it's in every cell, it floods the body with extra DMT. And it seems to be like us as spirit, you wouldn't say our spirit because it's who we are, right? But we as spirit is able to like, not disconnect, but get a little bit of space from the physical mental construct that we live in every day, what we'd call the mundane reality, right? You get a little bit of space and you start to see things in a different way and you feel things in a different way and you're imagining, you're visioning things in a different way, right? And it's healing all aspects of your physical body heals. Like you'll feel it. Like, well, I'm very physical. I move a lot, right? You see the way I talk. I'm very, so my body's like, whoa, moving and like stretching and whoa, like it'll go. Like I'll let it go. My mind will be taking me back to that time when I was 7 years old and I went through this stuff and I'm there and I'm saying sorry and I'm going through this stuff. And or I'm in this space of love and joy and oh my God, that was so beautiful. I just love my life so much. You go through everything. Sometimes they're hard. You're dealing with demons of the past that you haven't faced. Sometimes they're heart opening and loving and just you want to love on everybody. And you get out of the ceremony and you go and call all your friends and your family and you say sorry sometimes. You realize things about yourself. It heals you psychologically, which has a correlation to you physically. So as you're physically healing and you're letting go of the stress and the worry and the tension, there's a correlation in the psychological. So both are healing. One will heal the other will, one will heal that way. It'll, you know, they're all together. But ultimately, again, cleaning the body and mind, spirit, us as spirit becomes more able to flow through the crystalline form, right? So it's like spirit sort of takes a little expansion and is able to, it's the spirit molecule. So potentially there's like more healing love spirit energy inside the cells of the body and the body and mind is one. Therefore, there's a healing taking place in the body and mind. And as spirit sort of merges back fully again, and you're back in this reality after 7 hours or whatever, you integrate that healing and you integrate that new experience. I've always become a kinder, nicer, more loving person. I'm materially way more successful now than I've ever been pre-medicine. I met my wife after doing lots of medicine work and had stuffed up a lot of relationships before that, you know, so I attribute my wife sits with the medicine now too and is absolutely on the path. After the ceremonies she sat a week ago, she bought a shaman book, she's just ordered a flute, a flute from Estonia, the guy makes it in Estonia, you know, we're both on the path, on the medicine path for sure. And in the medicine journey you'll find there's a family. So here we call it like the medicine family. When I lived in Bali, we had a medicine family in Bali. In Australia on the Gold Coast, we had a medicine family. And the medicine family all gets each other. Because when you sit in circle, like we'll sit in circle here, there'd be 40 people, you know, and you're helping each other and you're sharing and you're connecting and, you know, somebody's purging, they're, you know, letting it out. Others are there to help. And in the morning, we cook food together and we just love on each other and care for each other. So you become a family, the medicine family. And there's a medicine family all around the world. Like I've sat with seven different shamans in seven different countries, medicine, right? Like, so I've seen lots of different medicine traditions. Doesn't matter where you go. You show up, there's kindness, there's love, there's connection. You're in the family, you're one with the family because you're all doing the work. Everyone who drinks and has the experience feels differently because of it. You've touched love in a different way. So medicine to me is, and especially like there's lots of different types of medicine. Cannabis is a medicine, right? In America, you can legally get it now. And I do use, I haven't in a while, but I have in the past, a little bit, one lungful of cannabis, hold it, let it out. And then I use that to connect with my body, to go for a walk in the forest, to heal, to stretch, to open, to help me to process things. Like cannabis is medicine, not for me anyway. I just have one lungful and then I'm able to use it. San Pedro, or called Huachuma, is another medicine from the cactus. Mescaline is the active ingredient there. It's in peyote as well. Beautiful heart opening medicine. Very, very gorgeous. Another great medicine has also DMT. It's another type of DMT called 5-MeO-DMT. So it's another molecule attached to the DMT molecule. We call it traditionally Sapo, S-A-P-O. Sapo is from the glands of a toad, not to be confused with the frog, the poisonous frog, where they burn the skin and they put the frog on and it makes you vomit and clean your system. I've never done that. I don't want to do that. It looks really intense. I've got friends that love it, but putting frog poison, burning frog poison and putting it in my arm. I don't want to do that. Purging it like crazy. But Sapo, you smoke one big lungful, you don't remember breathing out. And it is a full, it's like ayahuasca, which is 5-6 hours, compressed into 15 to 30 minutes. Just mind blown, full on. It's like the fast track, but it can be a lot. Integrating Sapo, and I've done Sapo 3 times, integrating Sapo can be very difficult. 5-MeO-DMT can be very, very difficult, which is why ayahuasca I like better, because it's more a controlled journey into my own healing, not the like, good luck, like push a button. Sapo is really full
bungee
on.
Bungee jumping.
Oh, man, it's crazy. It's great. It changed my life and I absolutely love it. But, and would I do it again? Yeah, I'd do it again. For sure, I'd do Sapo. Yeah, I'd do all the medicines again. But yeah, so I highly recommend it. I cannot recommend it enough. My caveat there at the beginning stands with, if you do have some, you know, psychological issues, do your research. If you're going to do it, have somebody there that's done it before that can care for you. Take a tiny little bit and just check it. There's always time. You know, you can do many ceremonies, but go very carefully. But if you're a sane, you know, not that they're not sane, but maybe they aren't. I don't know much about it. But if you are like in normal consciousness, go. And if you ask around, it's everywhere. There's shamans or facilitators pretty much everywhere. So you can get in touch with people, talk to people, you know, and there's usually someone who's got a connection somewhere for the medicine.
So good, Scotty. Well, we've at about an hour and 40 minutes. So just so you know, I just wanted to give you the opportunity to, one, is there anything else that needs to be said in this conversation regarding men, masculinity, or your journey? If so, please address that. And then we'll let people know where they can find you, and please deliver a final message to men. So whatever time you want to dedicate to that is yours.
It's more my throat. I can fairly feel my throat. I speak a lot every day, but doing 90 minutes in a tirade is, and thank you for your gracious questions and the space that you give for answering them. This is the most open format podcast I've been on, where I really get to go deep and share without having somebody like talk over the top or ask a finer question or whatever, just to actually express. So this format is very new and I find it very refreshing. So thank you. And I hope you guys as the audience connect with Gemma's way of interviewing as well. I think it's really, really powerful and appreciate it. So for the gents, I think now is the time to really be a man. It's time to be a man. Whatever that means inside of you now, it will grow and it will blossom. There are hard times that we are in and there are harder times to come. Let's just face the reality of where we're at. It's going to get harder before it gets easier. The gym workout is only halfway through. There's more sets, right? The backcountry hike is not over yet. The rucksack is still heavy, right? However you need to frame this adventure that we are on in life right now, we signed up at a time to become great men and great women. But you've asked me to talk to the men, right? But for women as well, everything I'm saying goes for the women except minus the man part, okay? We are here at this time to level up. We are here at this time to become all that we are here to be. And it's up to you to claim your place in this game. It is up to you to say to yourself, ultimately the universe, because you are a great spirit, to say to yourself, I am here for this time and I will do whatever it takes. I am guided, absolutely guided every single moment for walking this path. No matter how difficult it gets, there is always someone there at the back of the rack helping me lift that extra set, right? There is always somebody there helping throw the rope to pull me out of the marsh, the bog. There is always somebody there to support me. I know that to be true. I declare that to be true. And I will do whatever it takes to be this man that is bursting forth from inside of me. I'm doing it for me. I'm doing it for my wife, my partner, the ones that I love. I'm doing it for my little sister. I'm doing it for my brother. I'm doing it for my mum. I'm doing it for my dad who's passed away. I'm doing it for my uncles and aunties, both living now and have passed. I'm doing it for my cousins. I'm doing it for my nieces and nephews. I'm doing it for my neighbor. I'm doing it for the guy down the street. I'm doing it for the person on the other side of the world that will never meet me and that has no idea who I am. I'm doing it for them too. I'm doing this because I am a cell in an organism that is called life, because I am here and my voice matters, my energy matters, my path matters, the work that I do, whether it is seen or unseen, matters at this time. And I will do it to the utmost of my ability, because that is who I am. I am a man, I am a woman, born at this time, for this time, to be at this time the greatest version that I can be, to clean away the fear, to let the devil know that this ain't your space anymore. You don't get to reside in the temple of love. You don't get to reside in the temple of God, Great Spirit, that is this vessel that I am right here and now. It is time for you to be banished so that love can shine through, so that the rainbow family, the rainbow people can live here as we're here to be. All right, this is our time, but you have to claim it. Nobody else is going to claim it for you. Nobody's going to come and kick you and help you and push you. They may, but it won't work unless you say to yourself, I was born for this and I will do what it takes. Step up. There are so many of us around the world right now doing exactly the same. There's so many of us leveling up each day, facing our demons, facing demons that are not even ours, that were passed on to us from our ancestors. We're doing what it takes now. Join us. Be one with us. Again, even if we never connect physically, we never see each other, we never talk to each other, you do you, you be you fully, because that makes a massive impact through the neural pathway that is the human connection, this connectivity of amongst all of us in the living Gaia, right? It makes a difference. You are here to make a difference by being love, who you really are, by being yourself fully. So do the work, clear away the fear, clear away the muck, center in yourself who you truly are. Allow that love to shine through. That's all you have to do. And I'm doing it with you, and I love you. I love you for who you are. I love you because you are me. We are one.
Beautiful message, Scotty. Thank you. Where can people find you? And we'll drop all the links in the description below.
Cool. So I've got a bit of a unique name, Scotty Ze. So it's Scotty with a Y, Z-E. I'm pretty much on all platforms, although I mostly congregate on Facebook. Most of that shares over to Instagram, although I'm not very active on Instagram. So mostly Facebook, or just a .com, Scotty Ze, Scotty with a YZE.com, ScottyZ.com. Yeah, you'll find my podcast as well, wherever you listen to podcasts. My podcast is called Awaken Freedom. But if you just search Scotty Ze on Apple or Spotify or Stitcher or wherever you listen to your podcast, just search Scotty Ze. You'll see Awaken Freedom with Scotty Ze. I'd love to have you actually, Gemma. We're going to do a podcast with you, please. That would be amazing.
Yeah, why not? Yeah.
Yeah. It's just great conversations with beautiful human beings. Just diving into what is this awakening? We're awakening freedom. What does that look like in our lives? So some really cool guests and some fun conversations. And that is on YouTube as well. So you can search Scotty Ze on YouTube too. So Facebook, YouTube, podcast, probably the main ones. And then ScottyZ.com will give you everything you need.
Oh, wonderful. We'll get all those in the description below. Wow, what an amazing conversation, Scotty Ze. Thank you so much. You've brought so much, you know, just unique wisdom and knowledge and experience and, well, energy and character, you know, to this. So I want to give you a huge thank you, and loved having you on Heart Warriors.
Thank you so much, Gemma. I really appreciate it. I love what you're doing. And again, thank you for the format, getting to share. I've really enjoyed it.
Oh, my pleasure. Thanks everyone for being here. If you could like, share, subscribe, and I will be back in another couple of days with another episode of Heart Warriors. Bye. Bye. Stay honest, you want, Scotty.